Good morning, everyone. I call this meeting to order. Before we begin with introductions, just a reminder to place your phones on silent so we don't have any interruptions during the meeting. And we'll begin with introductions, beginning with Mr. McGuire.
Brendan McGuire, Halifax Atlantic.
Suzanne Lonescroft, Lunenburg.
Margaret Miller, Hanseast.
Joachim Stroink, Halifax, Chivucto.
Ian Rankin, Timberley Prospect.
Tim Houston, Pictou East.
Maureen McDonald, Halifax, Needham.
Dave Wilson, Sackville-Cobequid.
Thank you. Our witness today is the Department of Communities, Culture, and Heritage, and they will be discussing the Bluenose 2 with us. And Ms. Dean, I begin with yourself to provide an introduction and also the members beside you.
Thank you. And I assume my opening statement.
Yes, you, okay. Please go ahead with your statement if you wish directly after your introduction.
Thank you. I'd like to introduce to you our Executive Director of Archives, Museums, and Libraries, Rhonda Walker, who's been also very involved in the Bluenose 2 project as the project lead in our department. Bill Greenlaw, who's the previous project lead on the Bluenose 2. And Rebecca Doucette, who is our Financial Services Advisor. And I'm Kellyanne Dean, Deputy Minister of Communities, Culture, and Heritage.
Thank you, and please proceed with your introductory comments.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody and committee members. First of all, I want to thank you very much for this opportunity. Since becoming Deputy Minister of Communities, Culture, and Heritage last fall, I've gained a greater understanding of the complexities associated with this file and this project, as well as some of the misperceptions. Taxpayers deserve to know how their funds have been used and why the project is costing more than originally estimated. I hope that by the end of our discussion, you will have a greater appreciation for the complexity of this project and a renewed sense of pride in the anticipation of the Bluenose 2's return. You've asked me here to discuss the project as well as costs and delays associated with the restoration, and to do that effectively, I hope you'll permit me to first provide you with relevant background related to the project timeline and history. Bluenose 2 was built as a promotional replica of the original Bluenose by Olin Brewery in 1963, given to the province of Nova Scotia for $1 in 1971, and has been the province's sailing ambassador ever since. The Bluenose legacy has become an important part of Nova Scotia's proud maritime heritage and culture, and there's an expectation by many Nova Scotians that the province will protect that legacy on their behalf. I can assure you that all involved in this project are keenly aware of that. While Bluenose 2 had undergone substantial renovations over its 45-year history, it became apparent in 2007-08 that significant structural issues needed to be addressed. The most substantial item was hogging of the ship's hull and keel. Hogging is a term used to describe the distorting of the shape of the hull due to forces of gravity and buoyancy. As the weight of the vessel pushes down, the water pushes up. The bow and stern are pushed closer to the water. As the shape is distorted, it affects performance, safety, and maintenance. During 2007-08, government examined options necessary to keep the Bluenose 2 in operation. These options included continuing with ongoing maintenance and capital upgrades on an annual basis, a major restoration of the Bluenose 2, constructing a new Bluenose 3, or having the private sector operate the Bluenose 2. At that time, government decided that the best option was to pursue a major restoration of Bluenose 2. This would address the ongoing significant capital issue and protect the well-established brand. It was also decided that the restoration had to be done in Lunenburg in order to create further economic benefits for Nova Scotia. Premier Rodney MacDonald and Minister McKay approved the project in 2009 under the Federal-Provincial Infrastructure Agreement with a $14.4 million budget to be cost-shared 50-50 between the federal and provincial governments. Shortly after their election in 2009, the NDP government committed to continue with the restoration project. A project steering committee was formed in 2009, including representatives from our project management firm, MHPM, Transportation and Infrastructure Renewal, Finance, Justice, Procurement, Communities, Culture, and Heritage, as well as the Lunenburg Marine Museum Society. The steering committee oversaw the development of RFPs and evaluated proposals in accordance with provincial procurement policy. Throughout the project, they met regularly to provide input on key decisions. Contracts for project management, design, and construction were awarded to three firms between October 2009 and July 2010. MHPM was awarded the contract for project management, responsible for administering the design and construction contracts, providing overall project management support through cost control, schedule reporting, and project accounting. Lenkeek Vessel Engineering was awarded the contract for design, responsible for the design work, drawings, and ensuring the vessel meets the regulatory and classification standards. The Lunenburg Shipyard Alliance was awarded the contract responsible for the vessel restoration, project management for the construction, sea trials, and final handover to the province when the vessel is certified. The vessel's original delivery date was May 29, 2012. The total project costs have increased from $14.4 million to approximately $19 million. At the time this project was initiated, to our knowledge, no one in Nova Scotia had attempted to build a replica of a wooden vessel this size to meet modern-day compliance standards. This project is not simply a restoration or even a rebuild of the 1963 yacht. The completed vessel is a highly engineered modern boat with a design life of 50 years and will be fully compliant to modern safety standards. However, she will look and feel like a schooner. The vessel is built from high quality materials that provide longevity and contains structural steel to ensure that hogging does not occur in the future. The province decided to bring the vessel into class by the American Bureau of Shipping Standards, which means going above and beyond Transport Canada regulatory requirements. Class is an independent safety and quality regime which is undertaken for ships to demonstrate specific standards related to the bulk of the hull, mechanical, electrical, environmental, and safety-related criteria. Ships built to class standards must have documentation to demonstrate that appropriate materials have been used and that a specific regime of testing has taken place. This additional due diligence ensures that Bluenose 2 will meet the highest possible international safety standards and will be subject to periodic surveys throughout its life. If I could draw an analogy, it's like achieving ISO 9000 process quality certification for a manufacturing facility or LEED Platinum certification for a building. When the decision was made to take the vessel into class, it was agreed that any additional work over and above meeting the required Transport Canada regulations would be paid by the province through the change order process outlined in the contract. While the Auditor General's report will provide a more comprehensive assessment of the challenges that have increased costs and lengthened the project timeline, here are some of the issues. There were significant challenges with the design, fabrication, and installation of the rudder and steering gear. There were delays at various points throughout the project related to designs, drawings, approvals, and the change order process. And there was frustration and there were communications breakdowns between various parties which further complicated the project. The partners had never built a vessel like this before, a combination of modern state-of-the-art technology and tradition. New materials and techniques had to be blended with traditional boat building. As issues arose, it took time and consultation to determine how to move forward. Elements of this project required the participants to learn along the way, to work through challenges and to find solutions, some of which didn't always work the first time. Bluenose 2 is now undergoing final testing. The decision has been made to proceed directly to sea trials in order to test the vessel's systems, functionality, and seaworthiness. Following the outcome of the sea trials, there will be modifications required to solve outstanding issues with the rudder and steering and to ensure the vessel meets Transport Canada regulations and ABS certification requirements. Once the vessel is complete and certified, it will be handed back to the province by the builders. The construction of this vessel represents the ingenuity and craftsmanship of the province's shipbuilding industry and should be a celebration of an exciting achievement by Nova Scotians. As I conclude, I would like to thank the staff who've been working extremely hard for many years on this complicated and very challenging file. We hope that in the very near future, the vessel's return to sailing will once again bring positive recognition to Nova Scotia, the town of Lunenburg, and everyone involved in the design and restoration process. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Dean, and we will begin questioning now with, beginning with the Progressive Conservative Caucus and Mr. Houston for 20 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Ms. Dean, for the opening statements, and thank you all for being here today. I mean, the Bluenose 2 is a Nova Scotia icon, and it's an important asset of Nova Scotia. And Nova Scotians are concerned about her fate, and we're concerned about her fate. Back in January, the PC Caucus submitted a list of 55 questions about the Bluenose 2 to the Premier's office. I'm just wondering, have you seen those questions?
Ms. Dean.
Yes, I have.
Okay. Were those questions provided to you directly by the Premier's office, or how did they come into your possession?
I believe they were shared with me through the Premier's office.
Okay, I appreciate that. Were you given any direction as regards answering those questions?
No, I was not given specific direction with regards to answering them.
Okay, so the questions were provided to you, but nobody asked you to answer the questions?
I did not provide answers to those questions.
Okay. And since they first came into your possession, has anybody came back to you and referenced those questions from maybe the minister's office, came back and said, we have those 55 questions. Do you have any thoughts on those questions, or is it just something that they sent to you and kind of left it at that?
Well, I think that the questions were certainly provided so that at estimates debate, had there been any further follow-up on them, we would have used them and would have answered any of the questions that were posed to us at that time. They were part of briefings that I would have provided to my minister so that he would be prepared to answer any questions to that effect. So certainly we were interested in being able to brief our minister to answer any of them at the time of estimates debate.
Okay. So the questions were received, and the questions were answered to the best of your knowledge, and then you don't know what happened with the answers after that. They were just kind of in binders, I guess, in somebody's office.
Well, we would have used the questions to brief our minister so that he would have been aware of what Ms. McFarland's concerns were, and so that he would have been able to answer any of those questions during the estimates debate.
Okay. There was one specific question in the list of 55 that had to do with the American Bureau of Shipping Regulations. And in the list of 55 that was provided to the Premier back in January, that was question number 22, sorry, just for reference. And the question was a very specific question, and the question was, whose specific responsibility is it to fully understand and ensure compliance with the ABS? So back in January, our caucus had asked the Premier kind of who's keeping an eye on the ABS requirements. Mm-hmm. And I guess my question today is, what was the answer to that question?
Oh. Ms. Dean?
So the ABS requirements are an integral part of the build. When the decision was made to bring the vessel into class and to adopt the ABS classification standards, work that was done through the build, through construction, and also the design work had to meet ABS standards. So the project management firm, the designer, the builders, were all cognizant of the fact that the ABS standards had to be achieved. What that means is that from the time that decision was made until now, we are constantly referring to ABS for approvals on designs, for inspection approvals. So this has become an integral part of the build since that decision was made to move to those standards. And I should say that they are incremental to the Transport Canada regulatory standard. So they have been part of this project since that decision was made. So all people involved in the project are aware of the requirement to meet that standard. And it does have implications for certification, for testing, for approvals. Yeah. On design and many, many elements of the construction.
Right. Okay. So I guess everyone's responsible for understanding the requirements. Would there be one specific liaison between the department and the ABS?
Well, our project the designers would be liaising very frequently with ABS because designs and drawings needed to be approved by ABS. So they would have direct links, as well as the construction project manager for the Lunenburg Shipyard Alliance, because ABS would be required to come in and do assessments and testing throughout various points of the project. So there was direct contact with ABS by the project proponents. And as well, our project managers would be contacting ABS as well to ensure that things were proceeding as they needed to with inspections and certification.
Right. So the ABS stopped the test drive, the recent test drive, right?
So the recent test drive, there's a complicated relationship as well between ABS and Transport Canada that maybe I should explain. Transport Canada is the regulatory authority. And what they have done is they have basically delegated some of the their inspection authority to ABS. ABS serves two roles. They are an inspector for Transport Canada, and they are a class society, so they provide certification for us bringing the vessel into class. So there's a dual role. So when ABS indicated that we would be good to go to move the vessel away from the dock, their assessment at the time was, yes, you can do that. Ultimately, though, Transport Canada said, no, you need a specific certificate, which was the trial certificate. So the actual piece of paper, the trial certificate, had not been issued. And Transport Canada said, you need to have that. So we did not feel comfortable moving the vessel away from the dock without that certificate.
Okay.
So there's an interplay between ABS and Transport Canada,
sure, it
depending
like
on what we're assessing and inspecting.
It sounds like there is, and I respect that relationship. But I guess when the order was issued, or when the decision was made, let's say, to stop the test drive, where was the minister at that time? Was he on site, or where was he when this was all taking place?
Our minister was actually out of the country at the time.
Okay, and the timing of the test drive, that's something that had been established, was that a date that had been picked in advance, or was that something that just kind of popped up and said, let's do the test drive?
Right. the test drive was something that had been contemplated in response to issues that we became aware of, that we knew we had issues with the rudder and steering system. So what we wanted to do, based on the fact that we knew there were difficulties that we were having, once the steering system had been installed and it was tested dockside, we recognized that it was difficult to turn the wheel, and we knew that we needed to do further assessment on that. So the province wanted to have a pre-sea trial. So we wanted to be able to test that particular system while the vessel was moving through the water. And we felt that it would be really important to do that prior to going to official sea trials so that we could determine what options we might have and what steps we might want to take. So we had also made it a condition of the prepayment agreement that I think you have in front of you, that pre-sea trial occur because we were adamant that we would have the opportunity to have further assessment. And so the date was given to us by the builders, and they assured us that we could do the pre-sea trial on that date. So it was the builder's responsibility to ensure that that pre-sea trial could be executed on that date.
So that was an important date. It was an important test that was taking place that day. I think you characterized it as important. I don't want to put words in your mouth.
But it was important.
But did you find it odd that it was going to be taking place on a day that the minister wasn't even in the country? Was the minister aware of the date? Or?
Unfortunately, the minister's plans had been made. He was not available. He was away. We were operating under very, very tight timelines and negotiating an agreement in order to continue to move the project along as quickly as possible. The sea trial was important, and even though it did not take place, we still had the ability to do some testing and to do some assessment work because we had engaged an independent consultant to come to the vessel and to speak with the crew and to speak with the captain and to perform some additional testing dockside. So while we weren't able to move the vessel away from the dock, we nevertheless were able to do some further work to assess the situation.
It was a significant milestone. It had the potential to be a significant milestone.
Yes, but it also didn't prevent us from gathering some information that we needed to gather. It would have been more complete had we been able to move the vessel in the water and do some testing at various speeds with the crew. But having said that, we were satisfied that we were able to get some very important information dockside.
You don't happen to know where the minister was? Other than
he was on vacation.
Okay. We'll leave that one for right now. It's unfortunate that his vacation coincided with such a significant event in such an important file in his portfolio. I know I'm disappointed by that, and I'm sure lots of Nova Scotians would be disappointed to see where that might have ranked in the minister's scheme of things. But on the day that that happened, I guess as we're moving towards that date, were you comfortable with the date of the test drive? Did you have concerns building up to it?
I was trusting the information that I was receiving and believed that if I was told that that was the date that the pre-seat trial would take place, that it would take place on that date and that everything was in order for it to take place.
Okay, so you had no reason to express any concern to any of your colleagues maybe or the minister himself that maybe there was, that, hey, this is an important date. We're getting close to it. I have these feelings about it.
We've always been working towards sea trials as the ultimate, test of the vessel's seaworthiness. This pre-sea trial, we had been in conversations with the builders about the need to do it. They agreed that it would be worthwhile to do, and so we were moving towards achieving that.
Okay. In terms of what happened that day, I don't know what the proper description is, aborted or failed or whatever we might want to use, but there was an event that day, and it wasn't really the anticipated event, shall we say. You became the spokesperson on that particular day, and I'm just wondering, who made the decision that you would be the spokesperson for the department on that day? Because I have to tell you, I find it a bit odd that, you know, normally you'd see maybe a communications director. Maybe you'd hear from the minister directly, given the profile of this file, maybe the premier himself. I find it just a little interesting that you became the spokesperson for the department on this issue. Can you tell me how that came about?
Well, I think, we were reacting very quickly to the situation, so we only found out the day before, and it was late in the day, that this wasn't going to take place. But we knew that we were still going to go down to the vessel to do some further testing. I was down there. My staff were committed to finding out as much as we could about the status of the steering and the rudder, because we know that this is an important issue that needs to be resolved. And so I think partly because I was there and I had firsthand knowledge of what had happened, why it had happened, and what we were there to do, It just made sense for me to speak to media. There were many, many questions, and of course people were wondering what had happened, and I happened to be right there at the time, and I think that was part of the reason.
Is it very often that you find yourself the spokesperson for the department?
Depends on the situation, but generally, no.
Okay, thank you. Now, you were on site that day.
Yes.
Was there any elected members of the government on site that day?
No.
So the minister wasn't there. We know the minister was unavailable. The premier wasn't there. Maybe the MLA for the area, was the MLA for the area there that day?
No.
So there were no elected officials from the government present for this significant event. Do you have any comment on that?
Well, it wouldn't be required. It is a technical test, so we needed inspectors, crew, people that could execute the tests and provide oversight, so it wouldn't have been a requirement. I was there because my staff and I were very concerned about the outcome, and we have been trying to do everything we can to stay on top of the file, so we wanted to have firsthand knowledge of any findings or anything that was uncovered as a result of the testing that we did dockside.
In terms of events that it's required of an elected official to attend, I can tell you there's not a lot of required events, but generally elected officials attend a lot of events, and they generally attend ones that are of interest to them. I know myself, in my own constituency, I attend a lot of events because I'm interested in what's happening in the community. And I think if this was in most constituencies, you would see an elected official there seeing what's happening. So it might not have been required, but I don't know if you want to comment on your feelings about none of them being there that day.
No, I have nothing to add.
Okay. So when we think about, as this file's progressing along and things are happening in a significant file like this, I guess I'd ask you, how responsive has the minister been when you've had feedback for him or needed answers from him? How involved has the minister been in this file?
I can certainly speak to the period of time since I've become deputy minister on the file, and I can tell you that the minister has been incredibly involved in the file. Obviously, it took some time to get everybody up to speed. I was new to the file, as was he, but certainly when the issues were brought to our attention about the rudder and the steering system, this is something that really were of major concern to us and major concern to the minister. Now, the issues with rudder and steering are not entirely new. We know that even back in 2012 and prior to that, there have been many discussions and debate about the steering system, about this use of a steel rudder, about how that was going to function. But again, the only time to really see the system in action, I guess I would say, was April, when it was fully installed and we were able to actually see the steering work. And at that time, when we understood that it was very difficult to turn, the minister got directly involved, and we met with the project managers. We had discussions with the captains. He had discussions himself to try to understand the issue, to make sense of what our options might be for rectifying it, and to become fully informed about where we might go from there. So, the minister has been kept fully abreast, and he has been very involved, particularly on that issue.
Do you think the minister has you'd characterize it that the minister has a good understanding of the issues on this file?
I think he is gaining a solid understanding. It is a very complex file. It's difficult to brief somebody on all of the complexities, but certainly we have done our best to bring him up to speed on the file, yes.
The minister made a series of incorrect statements in the House here during question periods. He made some incorrect statements about the status of the sea trials. He didn't seem to understand issues surrounding the Bluenose, like who was the insurer and where were donations that were being made, where were they going. So we've always had some concern that maybe the minister didn't really understand the file. But I guess I'm hearing from you is that he had every opportunity to understand the file because he'd been briefed as things were progressing.
Yes, and there may have been specific questions that he may not have been briefed on, so he may not have had the answers to specific questions, but he has been briefed.
Mr. Houston, you have about 1 minute left.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chair. I know that from the onset of this new government, they considered the Bluenose to be an important file. I know that because they referenced the Bluenose in their speech from the throne. So we know that it was on their mind. Before it was referenced in the speech from the throne, were you consulted about that they were going to reference it?
No.
When you heard or read the speech from the throne, did you believe that the time frame that they had stated in the speech for the throne would hold up? Were you comfortable with that at that time?
Well, whatever would have been written in the speech from the throne, and again, I have to say, was I consulted? I'll have to rethink that. I may have provided information at the time. I don't recall. But having said that, any timelines or information that would have been used would have been based on our information, the best information that we would have had at that time, if that had been provided to them in writing the speech.
Order. The time has expired. We will now move to the NDP caucus and Mr. Wilson for 20 minutes.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for coming today. Little bit of maybe not controversy, but some debate over the last week, actually, after our public accounts committee meeting. There was a request to have Deputy Minister Darrow attend today along with you. to answer questions because, of course, knowledge of the decision of the government to remove the file from your department and yourself. So, bit interested in wondering why that wouldn't happen. I know Mr. Darrell is quite competent in his work, as are you, and we are concerned that he's not here today. So currently, as we sit here today, you have no interaction on the file. Do you still consult with the Deputy Darrell or the Premier's office on this, or you have no input on what's going on around the Bluenose refit?
Ms. Dean?
This department continues to be involved in the file on a day-to-day basis. So we are still managing the contracts for the file. We are still working with the builders and with the designers and with the project management firm in order to bring the vessel through to sea trials. So that day-to-day work continues. All the budgeting, all of that is still the responsibility of the department, so we remain very involved in the file.
Which is interesting because the optics, I guess, of what the announcement was on the, I believe it was the day of the sea trial, the 28th of March, May, that the Premier announced that you would be removed from the file, Deputy Minister Darrell would be put in place, and the Premier's office would be advising how to go forward with this project. Knowing the players involved in the department, I know they've worked extremely hard over the last number of years to try to ensure that taxpayers' funds and money are the number one priority with this project. Knowing that the decision to go into class or bring the ship into class, definitely there was going to be an increase in cost. And so it's interesting to think that the Premier now is, there's this optic out there that you no longer oversee the file, your department no longer has any input on it, and anyways, that's probably a question for the Premier now. Maybe we'll call him to the public accounts, but I don't think he'll come. So with the announcement on the 28th, the potential sea trials that were supposed to happen, of course, as my colleague mentioned, you were a spokesperson that day on that issue. When did you find out that the decision was made to remove the file, supposedly remove the file from you and give it to Mr. Darrell? Did the Premier's office call you that day and say, listen, you're no longer speaking on behalf of this project, we're going to have Deputy Darrell there? Or can you maybe advise us how that happened, or how did you find out that the file was now going to be overseen by Deputy Darrell in the Premier's office?
Right. So for clarification, Deputy Darrell has been added to the file to provide oversight and to work through solutions with respect to the rudder and the steering system. So I do believe that there is, you know, an enhanced capacity that's being brought to the file. So Deputy Darrow did phone me, and he let me know that that he was going to be providing oversight on the Bluenose project and that he was going to become involved. But he did not indicate to me that I was no longer involved in the file or that I still did not have a key role to play. So, you know, certainly we're looking forward to continuing to do what we're doing, to support Deputy Darrow in any way that we can from the benefit of the work that we've already done. And really, we all have one goal, and that is to get this vessel completed and to get her sailing again. And if that means additional resources of government come to play to make that happen, then I welcome that.
See, that's I think that's not the perception that was portrayed in the media that day, and so it'll be interesting to see what kind of response the government has on that. I know from working with many of your colleagues that they've worked hard to try to make sure funds are dispersed appropriately, and in the contract itself there is a mechanism. The additional cost that we're seeing comes from, of course, change orders that are a result of potentially bringing it up to class. But there is a mechanism, is there not, in the contract that kind of to resolve those disputes. Say if the department doesn't agree or the management group doesn't agree that these costs are because of bringing it to class. There is a mechanism that that can be resolved at the end of the contract, I believe.
Ms. Dean.
Exactly. So the change order process that's outlined in the contract is exactly as you have indicated. It is to address changes that are not part of the base contract or the base scope of work. So some of the changes that would be required to meet the ABS standard would be dealt with through the change order process, which means that that specific piece of work or a bill for that work is submitted separately under a change order request. Now, there is a significant number of those requests outstanding that are actually in dispute, and there is a mechanism in the contract for resolving them as you indicated. And first of all, of course, we try to see if there is a mutual agreement on the costs, and if that doesn't work, then we proceed to mediation, and that is an ability to have, you know, the documentation looked at by a third party who's independent, who has knowledge of shipbuilding and delay and the potential issues that could be faced, so that they can add some independent oversight to the documents and perhaps reach a solution that way. If we don't if we aren't successful mediating, then the contract allows for arbitration, an arbitrated decision. So just to frame that for you, really what we're looking at is outstanding change orders that we don't necessarily see eye to eye on. So there would be documentation that the province would have, there's documentation that the builders would have, and what we're trying to do is to figure out what those actual costs are, what's reasonable, and that's why that process has been put in the contract.
So throughout the project, of course, there was anticipated, this was anticipated, that's why it was built into the contract. When the contract or when the initial contract was offered, it was a tender, I take it, and it was MHPM Project Management that was awarded the contract. That's the normal process, right? There was a tender issued. So who made the decision to bring in an external, well, I don't know if it's called project management. I don't have it in front. It's in here somewhere. It's in the paperwork. An additional oversight group to see what was going on with the project. When was that decision made? Just within the last couple weeks or last 3 weeks?
I'm not sure what you're referring to.
Wilson Fit was just declared that they would oversee the project to a certain extent. For it could be up to $1,200 a day, so there's an additional cost. I mean, we have MHPM,
yes.
Lenkeek Vessel Engineering, Lunenburg Shipyard Alliance, so they all have contracts with the province. So who made the decision to bring in an additional company to oversee the project? Was it through the Premier's office? Was it through yourself as Deputy Minister in CCH?
No, I believe that was Deputy Darrow's decision.
Okay. So recently we heard comments from the Premier calling this a boondoggle, which is unfortunate, I think, because it, in my mind, it tarnishes the project and the importance of the project. And you mentioned in your opening statement a little bit on how important this was to, you know, one, be done in the manner it's being done in, two, being done in Lunenburg, for example, and really doing it in a way that kind of brings back the style of shipbuilding that has been in history for our province. And I know that there's workers down there that have come from all over the country to come back to Lunenburg to work, to build on this historic project, and I've talked to them. We've seen people around the world get involved through the website cast of the ship, offering coffees for the workers, which is just amazing. So when I hear the Premier come out and make statements like a boondoggle, to me that kind of erases all that good work that is going on. Do you have any comments on why he would call it a boondoggle? Has the Deputy Minister Darrell talked to you on why the Premier, looks at this as a boondoggle? Have you had any conversations with Deputy Darrell or the Premier on those comments and what that will do and what that has done to this important project?
No, I haven't.
When sea trials start again, I noticed that they had mentioned that you needed a Transport Canada ticket or signage or some kind of okay from Transport Canada. Would that not have been something that the project management group would have known about that they should have had in place? I don't foresee yourself as Deputy Minister, you know, writing that letter to Transport Canada saying we need this authorization. I mean, it would be within the management group that's overseeing it. Why do you think that was an issue? Was it just an oversight? They didn't think they needed it, or it was something that was missed at the opportunity of doing the initial sea trials?
I think that they believed they had the necessary documentation. I think everybody thought, based on comments from the ABS inspector at the time, that we were good to go for a pre-sea trial. Remember, this was not the official sea trials. This was, you know, a limited test that we were doing and moving the vessel away from the dock. We weren't doing full inspections or anything kind of related to the sea trial process. So I do believe at the end of the day that it may have been a gap in communication between ABS and Transport Canada, but I also, you know, believe that the people involved thought that they had what was required to do the sea trial on that day.
When we look back, I know we were in session, I believe, later on in November past, going into December. I know there was several questions to the minister talking about or asking about the project, and I believe on November 26th, the minister had stated, that the company has done good work on the restoration. Things were going well. There has been some cost overrun, which is anticipated. But he mentioned it here on the floor, and I believe in the media, that things were going well, and that there's been some good work being done on the restoration. And then some short. Were you aware of the minister making those comments, or first of all, and doing some media on the question around how the project is going?
Yes.
So 3 weeks later is when the minister came out publicly saying that the project needed to be publicly reviewed. So I believe that's at the time when the Auditor General was asked, or the Auditor General's office was asked to step in and have a review of that. What changed in the 3 weeks, or was there new information that came to the department that educated the minister on the need to change kind of his stance 3 weeks prior, saying that things were going well, work was progressing well, and then having to call in for a public review of the project?
Well, I think that throughout the project, there's been intense scrutiny, significant attention on the project. And, while at the time we may have felt that we were making progress and we were getting close to completion, because at that point I think we were 95% complete, and there were some outstanding items that needed to be addressed, but we hadn't fully appreciated the severity of what we were facing with the rudder and steering, because this was in November, December. But there were continued, concerns about the cost and the delay. And I think in the interest of transparency, it probably made sense for the minister to request a full review. I think he wanted a review, and he wanted to better understand some of the reasons for cost and delay. And I think that having it done independently by the Auditor General was a clear signal that he really wanted to have a transparent approach.
So what's the anticipated timeline now for pre-trial or pre-sea trials?
Sorry. So we are going to go straight to sea trials. I do want to make that clarification. Again, in an effort to expedite the completion of the vessel. So there's some work that's being done now, dockside, on some of the systems, just to finalize some of the testing there so that we have those approved. Once we receive approval, then we will receive a scheduled date for the actual sea trial.
So Transport Canada is involved. I'm sure you're making sure that all the paperwork will be in, be in order. So also in the announcement, when they announced supposedly that they took the file away from you, which we understand today that they really didn't, it also mentioned that the Premier's office would be involved. So who in the Premier's office are you meeting with or advising, or is it the Premier himself? Are you having regular meetings with the Premier to brief him on what's going on, or is there a staff person that from the Premier's office that is working with you and your department and your staff?
Well, I believe that Deputy Darrow will be reporting to the Premier directly. Deputy Darrow is the Premier's deputy, so he's going to be providing updates and dealing directly with the Premier on the file. You know, if I'm needed, I will provide my best advice, and I'll provide some information that's required as things unfold, definitely. And on a regular basis, on any file, we would liaise as required with the Premier's office if there were questions that they needed answers to from the department.
So with any project, it usually falls in the department. And then, of course, that minister is ultimately responsible for it. So I'm a bit confused now on who ultimately in government, elected official, minister or premier, is overseeing this project. Is it Minister Ince, or is it the Premier? So, I mean, how does that work? Is Minister Ince still involved as you are and your staff with what's going on and being briefed on this project?
We're continuing to brief Minister Ince on the project and keep him, you know, fully informed of any actions that we take. My authority comes from him on this file with respect to the contracts that we still have responsibility for executing.
Okay. So confuses me even more, because that's not what we took from the Premier's comments. So Minister Ince is still the minister overseeing the project. Go ahead, sorry.
Minister Ince is overseeing our work on the project because he is my minister. And I would say as well that the Premier and Deputy Darrow are going to be very involved, and they will provide oversight.
So they'll be very involved. So have you met with Deputy Minister Darrow over the last 3 weeks or 4 weeks now, I think?
Yes, I have.
Have you met with the Premier on this issue, or is it just Deputy Darrow that advises the Premier on what's going on?
Well, I haven't met with the Premier recently, but I'm sure that he will be briefed, well briefed.
Okay, so you haven't met with the Premier on, like, face-to-face on this file since he made the decision to supposedly take the file away from you?
No.
Okay. Kind of wish the other deputy was here, because then we could maybe get his side. So it's just interesting to me, and no disrespect to you or your staff. You know, my view of this, there's more political games being played than games being played within getting the restoration of the Bluenose done. So no disrespect to you or any of your staff. It's just interesting that the Premier makes those comments, indicating that the file is now moved. Someone else is overseeing it, but really, I mean, the staff, your staff, yourself, your minister is still involved in this project, which I think is important, because we want to make sure, as I said earlier, that taxpayers are ensuring that taxpayers' money is being invested appropriately. I know I only have about 30 seconds, so we'll wait for the second round. So thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll now move to the Liberal Caucus and Mr. Stroink.
Thank you very much. I guess I'm going to get right to the question here. In May of 2010, the contract was put forward by the previous government for the rebuild of the Bluenose 2. And the contract was signed and it was moved forward, but my understanding that it was moved forward without engineers signing off on the agreement. And my understanding also is today that the engineers still have not signed off on this agreement or on the drawings.
Ms. Dean?
I'm not understanding your question.
So the engineers sign off on a drawings based on the rebuild of the Bluenose, right? Because they would have some say on how things are going to be built, correct? Like, you would need engineers to build this boat.
Yes.
Right, and they haven't signed off on these drawings yet.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Stroik.
It's on the design and with the rudder and all that.
Okay, so we engaged a Lincaig Vessel Engineering, and they're providing design advice and support and expertise on the file. So I'm going to actually ask Rhonda Walker to provide some clarification perhaps on your question.
Ms. Walker.
So Lincaig Vessel Engineering, as the designers, are required to produce the design level drawings for the restoration, of course. Those drawings go to ABS, and ABS provides the regulatory stamp on them as approved drawings. The drawings I believe that you're referring to would be ones with a professional engineer stamp on them. So those aren't required to be provided to the builder. Only the approved drawings through ABS are required to be provided to the builder. Lincaig does, however, in their offices have copies of the drawings with the professional engineer stamp on them, and they have agreed in the past to make those available to the builder if the builder desire to have them.
So ABS hasn't signed off any of the drawings or any of the agreements?
ABS certainly has signed off on the drawings.
So when in 2010, in July, with the previous government, it says right here, and I'll table it gladly, in November of 2010, with the steel rudder and steering gear fabrication of installation, ABS has no approval yet, proceed at own risk. And I'll gladly table that document so you can see that. And it shows that if there was more involvement with ABS, then we might not be in a situation where we are today.
At that point, the rudder, and Deputy Mr. Dean has mentioned that the rudder is complex. It's one of the things that we have been dealing with since 2010, more so since 2011 with it. So there would have been initial drawings and designs done of the rudder that would have been submitted, and then discussions with ABS around whether or not those drawings were acceptable or not to ABS and to Transport Canada, and a lot of backing and forth. That's part of what some of the timeline has taken up with, is in finalizing what those designs are going to be. So in the end, we actually do have a design that is stamped approved by ABS for the rudder.
Okay, thank you. I'll pass it on to Suzanne.
Thank you, Mr. Stroink. Ms. Lonis Croft. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. The Bluenose 2 belongs to all Nova Scotians, but no community has a greater stake in the vessel than the town of Lunenburg. And throughout many unfortunate turns of events and continuous delays over the past 4 years, many questions have not been answered to the community. Facing the very real possibility of another summer with the Bluenose 2 remaining dockside and perhaps even inaccessible, I am bringing forward questions that are being asked to me as the MLA of Lunenburg. And this is on a daily basis. I get emails and I get phone calls and I get people dropping in my office asking many questions about the Bluenose. And Lunenburg will be continually impacted by this negativity if further delays continue in this project. And the negative impact on the tourism industry in the town with the loss of the Bluenose and added embarrassment of having promised repeatedly her return is perhaps most obvious. The damage to the reputation of our marine service industry may even be more severe and will undoubtedly be more long-lasting. I understand and appreciate that the problems were not yours. You came into the ministry past a lot of the decisions that were made. And I'm happy that the Premier has called this to the Auditor General in January, and that on May 14th, I had a letter presented here at Public Accounts asking that we speak of this issue today. So just for clarification, when I talk about the builders, I'm talking about the Lunenburg Shipyard Alliance. The engineers, I'm talking about Lincaig Engineering. The project managers would be MHPM, and the owners would be Community Cultures and Heritage. Whose responsibility is it to deliver the project on time and on budget?
Christine.
The answer to that is a complex one. You know, this This project, as you indicated, is made up of partners, three different partners. So the LSA, the designers, and the project management firm that's providing the oversight, and the owner, which is the province of Nova Scotia. So, delivering the project on time and on budget has been, the subject of much discussion. And you might recall that back in February, we had asked a naval architect to provide us with an independent assessment of what were the causes for costs and delay, because we were concerned about project timelines constantly being moved. And there are numerous reasons why that hasn't actually happened. Changes that have happened, delays that have happened, constantly moved the timeline. And the advice that we receive from project management firm that's providing our support for us in managing the overall project and the build, is that there were significant challenges that were experienced along the way, and it's been very, very difficult to meet some of the deadlines that we had expected to meet because of some of the difficulties in achieving the ABS standards, some of the difficulties receiving drawings, difficulties getting some of the certifications required on drawings to proceed with builds, the testing of materials. So really it has become a much more complex build than I think anybody would have anticipated at the outset. And ultimately, I think that probably all of the parties share some responsibility in the timeline and the delivery of the vessel.
Well, it's my understanding that the project manager, that's their job to deliver a project on time and on budget. That's why they are contracted, is it not?
That part of the project manager's role is to provide advice on scheduling. They are getting information from the builders with respect to the construction timelines. They are validating those timelines and estimates and providing that back. Sometimes those timelines aren't met. They are advising us. They are acting as our project manager on the file. So, it's a very, very complex build. And there are several moving parts.
So the project has not been delivered on time or on budget, correct?
It has not been delivered yet.
Okay. And it's on budget?
It's not on budget.
Okay, thank you. And how much was contracted out to the project managing firm to do this, and how much have they been paid?
The project management firm's contract was originally $375,000, and it has increased to $1.4 million. And that's a reflection of the length of time that has been added to the project delivery. So the project was based on a 2012 delivery time frame, and we are now in 2014. And it was important for us to ensure that we continued that contract to provide the management, the scheduling oversight, the costing, the budgeting, because they are ultimately responsible for all of that as well.
Okay. So you've continued to stay with the same firm?
Yes, we have.
Though they haven't delivered on time and on budget?
The knowledge that the firm has gained over the course of the project has been important for the continuity of the project. It wouldn't have been in our best interests at the time to change project management. As well, I think it's important to note that the project managers their responsibility also is to enforce the contract that is in place. And, there are limited remedies in the contract for us to use when delays occur. So, for example, if something isn't done to a scheduled time, one of the options we have that the project management firm, can use is the owner could take possession of the vessel and move it to a different builder. That wasn't an option that we were willing to consider. So when the project timelines shift, we are already halfway down the road and we have to determine what is the greater risk, changing the people involved in the project or working to try to continue to move the project forward and finding ways to mitigate the risk as we go forward.
You said that this is an important project, and it's an important project for all Nova Scotians. Typically, when someone is taking on such an expensive and costly endeavor, the project manager is on site. If we were building an annex onto the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, the project manager would be on site daily to make sure things are running smoothly. I understand there's an interview by Yvonne Colbert from Global News, June of 2013, where it is stated by the deputy minister that the project manager hadn't been to meetings or on site for 7 months.
Well, what I can tell you is that the actual construction manager would have been the point of contract for the point of contact for the project management firm for the build. So what that means is that the Lunenburg Shipyard Alliance that was actually doing the construction would have had a construction project manager in place, and that is the role that would be overseeing the actual construction and build. The role of the project management firm was to absolutely liaise with that construction manager, to liaise with the designers. They're providing overall project coordination. They participated in production meetings, but they weren't required to be on site as part of the contract. And
so they could be absent at critical times as well?
I'm not aware of specific times that they were or weren't there, but what I can mm-hmm. tell you is that they're providing the overall project management support for us, liaising with the key people that are involved in the construction of the firm and the construction of the vessel and the design of the vessel. And they are monitoring the overall schedule, yes, and looking at the timelines and obviously, you know, advising us when things are not on track, and then advising us on recommendations about how we should be dealing with that.
So there has been good communication, then, you'd say, with all the partners from the management firm?
I would not say that there has been good communication throughout the project. I think that there has been some difficulty in communications throughout the project, and I think that it got increasingly difficult, you know, towards the end of the project, because as costs mounted and change orders mounted and bills weren't being paid, I think that created financial pressures for some of the participants, and that created, you know, a very difficult and adversarial situation by mm-hmm. times. So, you know, to be frank, I don't think that communications probably was all that it could be, and that it has been challenging.
And has anything been done to rectify that?
We have been trying to meet more frequently with the builders. We have certainly been stressing the importance of trying to finish the vessel. One of the things that we have done is to advance payments, particularly because the change order process is a complex process, as I've indicated. And the fact that there is an outstanding claim there puts financial pressure on the builders, and I think that it also creates difficulty to finish and to complete some of the work. And so what we have agreed to do in order to alleviate some of that pressure and to keep the project moving forward is to advance payment against the outstanding delay claim to provide additional cash flow that will be credited against the ultimate settlement. But that enables the builders to continue with the work and to ensure that we're being fair, you know, throughout the project. So far we've advanced $800,000 against the outstanding delay claim in order to help alleviate some of the financial pressure.
So has the department ever considered dismissing the management firm?
No.
Never?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay, thank you. There have been many concerns about the steel rudder. When were the concerns first brought to the department?
I believe that the rudder has been the subject of ongoing discussion and debate beginning in 2010. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I am aware that the design and the ultimate design that we have now, again, has been a constant source of debate and I think concern. I know that the builders were very concerned about it. The original plan was to go with the wooden rudder and the original steering gear, which was fisherman steering gear. So originally that was going to be supplied and that was going to be part of the build. And it became apparent that that was not going to be approved by ABS. So remember, when we made the decision to go to class, all those materials had to be tested and they had to meet the ABS standard. And we were advised that the wooden rudder wouldn't work and also that we were going to have to look for other solutions. And there was considerable discussion and debate back and forth between the builders and the designers and as well ABS certifiers to arrive at a solution that everybody could agree on. And, you know, that was particularly difficult in a context where you have tradition really at odds with the modern technology and the modern standards and the ABS classification. So what was important was to try to find a way to marry the ABS approved configuration for the rudder and the steering with something that was still going to resemble a traditional schooner. So what we ended up with, based on advice from and the recommendation of our designers who were experts and we were assured that this would work, would be a steel rudder and also gear that had fisherman steering gear, which had to be reconstructed out of materials that could be certified and tested and meet an ABS standard. So, you know, this issue is sort of run throughout the project since the beginning. And as I said earlier, it was only, evident that I think it would be April when it was all assembled that it wouldn't be working to the performance level I think that we would expect.
So how many refits have there been of the rudder?
Sorry?
How many refits of the rudder?
How many refits of the rudder?
9, 10?
I read 12, but I don't know if that's accurate. Okay, so I don't have an exact number for you, but what we know is that there have been at least 7 design changes on the rudder. So back and forth, can we use this, can we use that, will this meet ABS, will that meet ABS? So yes, significant changes with respect to arriving at a design that would actually then be built.
And would you agree that bringing the ship into ABS classification is the main reason why the cost overruns have occurred?
I would say it's a contributing factor. I don't think it is necessarily the only reason. I think there are several reasons, but I think that that may be
proportionately, though, it would be.
It could be. However, we did have an opinion from a naval architect who said that he would have expected that the costs of bringing a build, such as the one we were attempting to do, into class would have been in the vicinity of about 5 to 6% of the overall cost. So, yes, it has contributed to the costs. I don't know exactly how much. And I think that that is an issue that is the subject of the outstanding delay claim. How much of the delay do you attribute to bringing the vessel into class and the numerous changes that were made? How much may have been things that needed to be redone through error or other reasons? And, you know, how much of it was requests that the owner may have made for a change that needed to be done. So it's a web.
Order. Ms. Lonas-Croft, the time has expired. We'll now move to the PC Caucus with Mr. Houston for 14 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, I'm just sitting here and I'm thinking, you know, lots of projects that are undertaken, whether it be building a building or whatever, sometimes there's often problems and challenges. And really the issue is, how do you solve them as they come along? So I'm just wondering, like, as you're when you come onto this file and you're progressing along and you're seeing all these difficult relationships and adversarial relationships, many times what people would do in that situation is they go to their boss and they'd say, hey, boss, I'm having these issues on this thing. Can you give me some guidance? At any time during this process, did you go to the minister and say, look, here's all these issues that are happening. What can you help me with this? Did you reach out to the minister and look for guidance on some of these issues?
Certainly kept the minister abreast of it, and I think that as we became more familiar with the file, we recognized the need to try to listen to all the parties, try to really understand what the root of the issues were. And, you know, sometimes it wasn't obvious. So, you know, really we did, at the outset, listen to the staff who had been involved in the project for many years, get their perspectives, try to understand where they may have been encountering some difficulties, try to understand where each of the parties involved may have been encountering challenges, and then try to see what we could do about it. And I think, you know, one of the main issues that I became aware of when I became involved in the file, you know, were the financial challenges and the outstanding claim and the fact that that was creating tension in the relationships, because the role of the management or the project management firm that we hired was to oversee costs, to look at scheduling, to look at budgeting, and to say, you know, they had the ability to approve invoices and they validated the invoices that were received and they approved them based on the substantiating documentation. So if there was a tension that was emerging, it was that there were outstanding invoices that weren't being paid because they needed to be properly validated.
Mr. Houston?
Thank you. So during that process, how involved was the minister? Was he sitting down with you and saying, well, here are all these issues, let's try and do this, or here's my suggestion, or did you get any guidance whatsoever from the minister on how to resolve some of these, you know, monumental issues that you were seeing develop?
The minister was involved in the decisions that were made and basically gave us the approval we needed to move forward.
So in terms of kind of just very specific issues, I know the MLA from Lunenburg raised a number of concerns about the management company and the third party that was responsible for some of that stuff. And she referenced maybe perhaps a management company not being on site for 7 months, I think was the number. And so if the member from Lunenburg was aware of that, presumably the minister was aware from that, was aware of it. Was the minister okay with that? What was his guidance to you as this was happening?
I'm not sure what time frame we're talking about in terms of the project manager's presence on site. So, you know, I can't speak to that. That may have been prior to my participation in the file. What I do know is that, you know, they were very much involved since I've been on the file. They have been attending many of the production meetings to ensure that work is moving forward. So
as they attend these meetings, they're happy with what they see? Or are they providing guidance? Or are they just present? Or how would you actually characterize their actual involvement? Would it be hands-on? Would it be indifferent? And I'm talking about over the winter as this really started to develop. Mm-hmm. How would you characterize that? Hands-on, is that a good expression?
Yeah. I'm consulting with Rhonda because Rhonda attended many of those project meetings as well. And, you know, yes, they were hands-on. They were advising us of issues. They were advising us of some of the challenges with the timelines. So, you know, the closer we got to the completion of the vessel, the more, you know, rigorous we were managing the efforts to complete.
So your team, that's, you know,
yes,
your colleagues, your supervisors, they were there and they saw what was happening, and they were part of what was happening, in essence. So with that in mind, were you surprised to read, and I think it was the Globe and Mail, when the Premier referred to the entire project as a boondoggle, his team would have known what was going on. Did that kind of surprise you for him to come up with an expression like that at that time?
You know, I can't speak for why the Premier uses the expressions that he uses. What I know is that it has been a difficult file. It is very complex, as I stated earlier, and I think that there is a growing level of frustration at the fact that it's not completed. So, and I think that that's a genuine frustration that many people feel, the constituents of Ms. Lonescroft in Lunenburg, our staff, everybody working on the project. We all want this to be completed and we want it to be done successfully. So, you know, in the final stages of the project that we're in now, it's really important for us to continue to stay focused on the end goal.
So after, at that time, when that expression was made by the Premier, which was, you know, a few months ago, do you recall any specific action he took at that time to get more involved in the file?
Who took?
The Premier, sorry. When the Premier referred to this as a boondoggle, do you recall then the Premier then, with having formed that opinion and come to that conclusion on the status of the project at that time, did the Premier take any action at that time, and this is a few months ago, probably even before the House sitting, I think. Do you remember him taking any action to get more involved? Did he turn up at a meeting?
I don't recall a specific action. I can tell you that I did provide briefings to the Premier as requested.
How many times have you been to the Premier's office to discuss this file?
Probably a couple of times.
So the Premier was reaching out directly to the team here to get his information on the status of the file?
Well, and for clarity, it would have been with my minister present, so we would have provided briefings to the Premier because, again, it's a very high-profile file, something that's very important to everybody, and, you know, we wanted to ensure that the Premier was briefed as well, as I would expect my predecessor would have briefed Premier at the time as well. So, you know, as part of ensuring that he understood the project, we would have had several briefings, which included the minister.
So since coming into office, would you, well, you'd say the Premier has been involved in the meetings, updating the status, the briefings on this file, he's been involved in those meetings since coming into office. Let's go back to maybe October, November. He's been pretty involved in this file, would you say?
Well, what I would say is that we would have provided briefings as you would expect we would provide prior to the House sitting, or if there was an issue that we felt that the Minister and the Premier needed to be kept aware of.
Okay. Now, this is a project that was over budget when you received it. When you came along, the project was already a little over budget at that time. So when you were new to your position, did you make some recommendations as to how to changes to be made and that how the project was going to roll out going forward?
So when I came onto the project, the vessel, I was told, was 95% complete. So the majority of the work had already been done. So really what we were doing at this point was resolving some of the outstanding change orders, trying to figure out how we would deal with that. There were some invoices that had not been paid, so that we would need to get additional funds, request additional funds in order to do that. Which, as I indicated earlier today, has brought the project up to $19 million. That is our current estimate of what the costs are. So, you know, in reviewing where we were, you know, my role was to hopefully get the project finished and ensure that we had the resources in place to continue to complete our work under the contracts.
Thank you. So at that time, when you were new in the position, and you did identify some issues around invoices and things like that, you would have had some recommendations on how to resolve some of those issues. Would those be recommendations that you made to the minister, who was a new minister at the time, probably anxious to get information on the status of the file, hopefully, and you would have seen what you've seen, and you would have made some recommendations to him on, hey, this is how we go forward from here.
Yes, I mean, we would have had conversations with the minister, many briefings with the minister, to discuss the status of the project. It's, again, complex file, many moving parts. And so, yes, he was involved in those decisions, absolutely.
So he would have accepted your recommendations, and then you would have implemented them, probably. Is that the process?
He would give us the approval to implement the recommendations, and we would do that.
Has there been a time over, you know, the last 5 or 6 months where this team has made recommendations that approval has not been granted?
Not that I can recall.
Okay, so and particularly there's no significant things that you said, hey, we should do this a little different, and went to the minister with some suggestions, and he said, no.
No.
Okay. So here we are today. What needs to happen to finish this project?
We need to get the vessel to sea trials. And that will be another milestone in the project, because the sea trials signals that we are towards the end of the project. Now, having said that, I do recognize that there may still be work required on the rudder and the steering system. But getting the vessel through to sea trials will put her through the rigorous testing that's required, go through all of the certification process. All the inspectors will be there to look at the various systems to provide comments. So after the sea trial process, I expect we'll get a report, and it will say what systems meet the tests, where it's certified under the class system, under Transport Canada regulations, and if there are any things that have been identified that may still need to be addressed before she would be certified as seaworthy, and before all of the paperwork is done. So it is the responsibility of the builders to ensure that the sea trial process moves forward in a timely manner, and that all the necessary paperwork is completed so that the vessel can then be handed over to the province. So, you know, in my mind, the next significant milestone is the completion of the sea trials. And again, you know, Deputy Darrell will be intimately involved in working through a solution for the rudder and the steering system. So that is something that will also have to be addressed. So those are the two things that will need to be done to bring this vessel to completion and to get her sailing again.
Will it sail this season?
You know, I can't say. That will depend on the outcome of the sea trials, and it will depend on what work is going to be undertaken around the rudder and the steering system.
Do you know what the intended use of the Bluenose 2 is once it's finally complete?
She is a passenger carrying vessel. That, I believe, is how she will be certified. You know, she will have a crew that will be taking people for day sails as well in and out of ports that she visits, and she will actually sail from port to port and be the province's sailing ambassador, as she was before.
Okay. I'm just wondering, do you have any specific requests or recommendations that you've made as of today that are sitting with the minister or the premier waiting for responses?
No. Order, the time has expired. We'll now move to the NDP caucus and Mr. Wilson for 14 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just want to go back to something you had indicated in your opening statement. You had said that there was frustration and a communications breakdown between the various parties that further complicated the project. Could you maybe elaborate on what the communication breakdown, or what you have identified the communication breakdown to be?
Ms. Dean?
Right, and I talked a little bit about that earlier. I think that, you know, the change order process grew into more of an adversarial process, you know, because it served to delay payment. And I think that created a lot of frustration. And, you know, the other area where I think that communications has been difficult would be, you know, this tension between building a vessel that's true to her historical nature and tradition, something that looks traditional, but that has to be, has to meet modern day standards and has to meet ABS certified standards. So I think that arriving at solutions that met both needs was the subject of a lot of tension and a lot of debate by times. And I think there were, you know, elements that people thought they could use in the vessel, the original vessel, that turned out that we couldn't, that, you know, caused some a lot of debate and discussion, again, because we wanted to try to remain true to the original designs.
And I think that's part of the importance of this project is that here we have the Lunenburg Shipyard Alliance, which is comprises of three companies that used to compete against each other. We've got Covey Island Boatworks, Snyder Shipyard, and Lunenburg Industrial Foundry and Engineering. So these companies used to compete, and I know they take a lot of pride in this project. But is it correct that the techniques they're using is kind of the old style techniques to redoing the Bluenose 2?
Absolutely, and that has been one of the wonderful things about this project is that we can celebrate the traditional craftsmanship and the traditional boat building techniques that have been used throughout the project. And you did highlight the notion about pride. I think as well that some of the communications challenges are about the intense pride and passion that people have for this project and for their involvement in the project. And, the Bluenose inspires people, and the people involved in the project feel very, very strongly about their participation, and I think that is part of some of the challenges at times. But Rhonda can explain a little bit about the traditional workmanship, the traditional craftsmanship that has been used throughout the project, and I'm just going to turn it over to you for a moment to explain some of that.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Walker?
One of the things with a project like this is that when we talk about restoring something like Bluenose 2, is there a lot of options for what does that look like? And potentially it could have been something that was a very high-tech, perhaps fiberglass hull on the vessel that could be made to look as though it was made out of wood, and maybe somebody standing on the wharf wouldn't be able to tell the difference. But for us, it was important to keep the tradition of Nova Scotia's wooden sailing vessels. And so we had the Lunenburg Shipyard Alliance construct a wooden hull using traditional shipbuilding methods. And so anyone that went down to that site would have seen these angelique planks being manually lifted up to the ribs of that vessel and then being affixed with what I'll call spikes manually, with one person hanging on to it and another person wailing on it, for want of a better description, with a maul. And 10,000 of these went into the vessel. And then as they were doing some of the finishing and fine points of that hull, things were being sanded by hand. Things were being fared by hand. When you look at what's between the planking on the hull of the vessel, you won't see because there's paint on it, but as part of this process, there was cotton that was twisted and put into it, and oakum that was twisted and put into the spaces between the planking. So I think there was something like 28,000 linear feet of hull that had to be fixed with oakum and cotton. And all of that was done using traditional boat building tools, all done by hand, incredibly labor intensive, and something that the shipbuilder is very proud of, because all of this traditional woodworking that's going on is attached to ribs that were state of the art, and so you have just this wonderful combination of something that's high tech and something that is incredibly traditional, and any wooden boat builder would be able to stand there and say, yeah, I know exactly what they're doing when they're doing this.
So with that, of course, I think everybody would recognize the timeline that could be moving, doing most of it by hand, as you indicated, and it goes back to my original question around the communications breakdown. I know and understand that you have different opinions on, you've just mentioned going to a fiberglass hull or staying with the traditional wood frame. So you have a number of individuals with their opinions, and that I think would have probably led to some of the communications breakdown or some of the opinions being different and taking some time to figure that out. Would you agree with that?
Yes, I would agree with that. And because there was, again, the rudder's a great example of that, because there was considerable debate about what we would do, how it would be designed, what it would look like, whether it would look traditional or not. And there were various solutions and ideas proposed. And again, people felt very, very strongly about adhering to the tradition of the build and the schooner, and the vessel itself. And so, you know, that was another area where the traditional steering gear coupled with a steel rudder was something that was within the spirit of the Bluenose, but its functionality was a bit challenging. So,
so we're at a point now where I don't know what percentage of the vessel is complete. It's high.
It's high.
Very close to having it completed. So I think we both agreed that there was a number of people involved with opinions, and so I think we're at a critical point now where decisions need to be made, and we need to execute them and have the vessel completed. My understanding from the start of this project, it was a steering committee formed that had representatives from the MHP&M, Transportation Infrastructure Renewal, Finance, Justice, Procurement, Communities, Culture, and Heritage, the Lunenburg Marine Museum Society, were all part of this steering committee. Now we see the Premier, who announced not too long ago, 3 weeks ago or so, that they're adding an additional oversight of the Deputy Darrow and the Premier's office. Are you confident that these decisions can be made? I'm worried now that there's another level of input from the Deputy Darrow and the Premier's office that may delay things further. Are you concerned that now you not only have to deal with, since you've acknowledged today that you're still overseeing the project, deal with all the builders and that, but now you have to take one more step and brief the Deputy Minister of Deputy Ministers, I think that's his title, the Deputy Minister of Deputy Ministers, the Deputy Minister of Internal Economy too, and the Premier's Office. Are you concerned that there'd be a delay there? I'm concerned because you've mentioned today in a previous answer that you haven't directly met with the Premier in the last, since the 28th when when the Premier released the fact that Deputy Darrow would be overseeing this. So are you concerned that it will create additional delays because of adding another kind of component to making decisions about finalizing and finishing the Bluenose?
I hope it's going to expedite the process. You know, that's my hope, and I think that with resources that are absolutely focused on the element of the build that is still unresolved, that we still need to look at, that will help to finalize the vessel and to get it sailing. It's, again, that is everybody's goal, is to get this vessel finished as quickly as we can and to get her sailing again. And, we will work with Deputy Darrow and his team and do whatever we can to help that process go along as quickly as possible.
Yeah. So we mentioned today, or you mentioned today, it's at $19 million roughly, estimated cost. I think less than a week or a week ago, maybe 2 weeks ago, it was at $18 million. So for a week, it's jumped about $1 million. What's the difference between the figure released by, I believe, the minister about a week and a half ago to today, that it's around the $19 million mark?
So there was additional work that was done that was validated through the change order process that needed to be paid, and so that accounts for the difference between the 18 and the 19.
Okay. And those, the change order, who approved that? Like, did it come to your office, your desk, or did you have to go to Deputy Darrow to approve that, or the Premier's office was, or did you? And the Minister of CCH approved that?
Well, we would have to go to Cabinet for approval to increase the budget for the project, because it's tangible capital asset.
Okay,
money
so
that's
you
required.
Went to Treasury.
So we went to Treasury Board,
yeah, okay.
TCA.
Okay,
yeah.
Understood.
Yeah.
Now, we know recently also throughout the project there was some question around copyright and moral rights involving the Bluenose too. And then there was a settlement recently of $300,000. Is that included in the additional $1 million that you asked Treasury for?
No.
So where does that fund come from? Is that coming out of Communities, Culture, and Heritage budget, or did you have to go and ask for additional $300,000 for the budget for this year?
That came from our existing budget. So the department's budget, through our own budget, we were able to use that towards the settlement.
So
we had that in our budget.
Okay. Yeah.
We didn't have to do an incremental ask.
Who made the decision to settle that? Did it come? Was there a recommendation from staff to the minister, and the minister made the decision, or did it go to further? Did it go to cabinet to make a decision on who would approve the settlement, or going or taking the action of settling it instead of maybe holding off?
Yeah. So our minister would have received. Well, our minister was supportive of settling the project, and we provided instruction to the lawyers to that in that respect, and they negotiated the settlement.
So the minister agreed with settling it. So where did that recommendation come from? Did it come from staff, or did it come from somewhere else?
Yes, the recommendation to settle came from staff.
And was that after maybe a legal opinion on the case, or was there anything that changed over the last number of years? Because we're aware that that's been an ongoing issue. What triggered the department and staff to make that recommendation? Did something change over the last month or two? Was there a pending court date coming up? How did that transpire?
I think as we went through the process, this government wanted to pursue a different approach, and that approach was to settle versus a previous direction, which was to continue to go to court to pursue it in court. So upon receiving direction that settlement was a preferred option, we proceeded down that road.
Order. Mr. Wilson, your time has just expired. We will move to the Liberal Caucus and Mr. Rankin.
Thank you. I just want to talk briefly about ABS and the change orders and cost overruns briefly. So given that the province decided to bring the vessel into class by the ABS system, I'm just wondering, if it was the government of the day that decided that, why would the decision be to impose those ABS standards if it's not required? Who decided at the outset to go with the wooden rudder and traditional steering system when the project was created? And why didn't they check when they decided at that juncture to go with the wooden rudder? Why wouldn't they check with those ABS standards that they imposed upon themselves? Because clearly ABS said that no approval was given yet. Proceed at their own risk, as my colleague mentioned earlier, and that report was tabled.
Ms. Dean?
When did we start? Decision to go with ABS? Okay. So let me just revisit the decision to go. I'll start with the decision to go with ABS, and then maybe you can remind me of your other questions after that. So the decision to go with ABS was being contemplated at the beginning of the contract that was being negotiated with the builders at the time. So the contract actually, if you look at it, says that the build is to be to the Transport Canada standard or regulation, but that also consideration may be given to the classification standard ABS. So that's the American Bureau of Shipping. So the decision to go with the American Bureau of Shipping standard was made because Transport Canada, there's two things. Transport Canada at the time was delegating its responsibility for inspection to the American Bureau of Shipping. So they were going to be the inspector. We also thought this is an opportunity for us to have a vessel that is going to meet the highest possible safety standard, and that having her brought into class was a way to ensure that we were ensuring the safety of our passengers and crew to the best of our ability. So there's four organizations worldwide, I believe, that that can bring a vessel into class, or that have certification capacity internationally to bring a vessel into class. ABS is one of them. Lloyd's of London is another. There's two others. we did approach Lloyd's of London and ABS, and it turned out that ABS was the chosen classification society for us. So, when the contract was being negotiated, it was actually signed before the decision was made firmly that we were going to bring the vessel into class and go to ABS. So, although you know the builders were aware that we might eventually walk down that road, and that it could be a component, that decision wasn't made until after the contract was signed. So at that point, we needed to say, okay, well, how are we going to deal with costs associated with that and the impact that that will have on the build as we go forward? And that's why the change order process becomes really important.
So again, when was it decided to go with ABS, and was it the minister of the day that decided that?
Been 2 to 3 months, 2 to 3 months after the contract was signed, so would have been okay, so probably December 2010, so several months after the signing of the contract.
And
it would have been the decision of government.
Right.
And the steering committee, sorry, I should add, the steering committee would have also played a role in that decision.
Right, so relative to the change orders that seemingly are causing a lot of the cost overruns with the project, would that be correct to say?
No, the change orders are actually your mechanism for assessing what cost overruns
what
might
cost
be.
What cost overruns, exactly. Yeah.
And ABS, the requirements to go to ABS would be part of those change orders, but there are others as well.
Okay. So when the contract was drafted by the prior government to address change orders, because there's always change orders in projects, certainly in the private sector, I've experienced many of them. And whenever there's a dispute about some of these change owners orders, there's suppliers oftentimes aren't paid. So I'm just wondering, did the prior government ensure that specific clauses were in these contracts protecting the province and the taxpayers, therefore, when these cost overruns were taking place?
I'm to my knowledge, in the contract, there isn't anything specific about suppliers. So the subcontractors, it's responsibility of the, in this case, the builder, to pay its subcontractors.
So there's nothing in the contracts to protect the taxpayers for any of these change orders?
No, there.
Other than bringing the build somewhere else, as you mentioned before.
So the change orders represent money that is owed,
that's
have
above
not
and beyond
been paid.
What was estimated, right?
So the due diligence in the contract would be the process that we are going to go through to validate those change orders, the cost of those change orders, to ensure that taxpayers are not paying more than they should for work that was done.
Okay.
So there is a rigorous process and a due diligence that will be followed to examine those outstanding change orders and make sure that they represent work that was done and that they are paid accordingly.
Okay. And I just one more brief question before I pass it on to my colleague. Is there anything, given that you said that this is a difficult, complex, adversarial project given to the new government, is there anything that you perceive that the new government could have done differently given the myriad of issues that we're facing in terms of the seven different rudder designs and LSA declaring a number of times that their concerns over the last number of years? Do you think the government should have taken a different approach?
You know, all I can speak to at this point is really, I think what's important is to stay the course and to finish the vessel. And anything that we can do to make that happen is what I think needs to continue to happen.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Rankin. Mr. McGuire.
How are you all today? So thank you for coming. I'm just going to be, I just need a quick answer. When was the decision made to have the AG investigate this file? I think we know why, but we just want to know when. So I know you may not have the exact date, but if you have...
I think it may have been January.
In January? Okay, so it seems to me that it would be fair to say that after years of mismanagement that started under the Conservatives and continued under the previous NDP government, it was this Premier, this Minister, and the current MLA from Lunenburg that showed leadership and accountability when they decided it was time for answers and time to be responsible to all Nova Scotians. And with that, I'm going to pass to the MLA from Lunenburg.
Okay. Thank you. And I just want to go over when you were deciding whether to go with Lloyd's of London or
or the ABS classification. I've had conversations with members of the steering committee who said it was their recommendation to go with Lloyd's of London for several reasons, that the community is familiar with Lloyd's of London. Many boat builders on the South Shore use that company. And why was their advice overlooked?
I don't believe their advice was overlooked. I believe that we did approach Lloyd's of London, but that they were not prepared to do the project. And that's why we went with ABS.
And you have that documented somewhere, do you?
I can check.
Okay.
Okay. I can follow up on that for you, and certainly.
And, okay. Yeah. And so when was the last time the steering committee with all members met?
May the 2nd.
And all members were currently there?
Most of them were. There were a couple who were unavailable.
Okay. And was that a regular occurrence, that members were missing from the steering committee for meetings?
Honestly, I guess I'm looking to Rhonda, because Rhonda would have been participating in the steering committee meetings. So there were times when some members were unable to attend.
Mm-hmm. Any for long periods of time?
Sorry, Ms. Walker.
There definitely were periods of time when other commitments that steering members would have had would have prevented them from being there. I think one of the things to remember is that for some of the steering committee members that were not employees of the department or not employees of government, that they would have had other commitments that they would have had to have been able to address. But they were kept apprised of what was happening with the project through the monthly project update reports that went to them.
Okay. So who was advising the department, the government, the owners, to go with classification?
Ms. Dean?
Okay. Sorry. I just wanted to validate that. So the designers recommended that we go with the ABS standards because it provided the highest quality of safety. And that recommendation went to the steering committee, and the steering committee agreed. And so that's how the decision was made to go with ABS.
Okay. And the steel rudder, could there not have been a wooden rudder used for the boat?
Right. So I understand that that a wooden rudder couldn't have been used because Transport Canada wouldn't have allowed that, and also because it couldn't have been attached to the steel stock. Rhonda, would you like to add to that?
So with the rudder, there were a number of design challenges with the build. The first was that initially when we thought that we would be able to use a steel, a wooden rudder and the traditional fisherman's steering gear that had come with the vessel. When we actually started to look at what would need to be required, we discovered that the rudder stock itself would have had to have been, if it was going to be wooden, would have had to have been over 20 inches in diameter. And what that would have done would have been to have completely distorted the stern of the vessel and would have made the connection of the lazarette part of the stern of the vessel not the way that it needed to be. It wouldn't have been as strong as would have been required for the vessel. It would have weakened the stern end of the vessel. And so the decision was that the best material to use would have been to go to a steel rudder stock. There were issues around whether or not wood would have had the strength to be able to handle a vessel like Bluenose 2. And yes, it was something that was on the vessel for 45 years, but that was a vessel constructed without the same standards that we have today. Transport Canada or ABS, it just wouldn't have worked to meet those standards. And so in trying to find a substance that was going to meet what the strength requirement was, steel was what was settled on, that would meet the requirement for strength.
Ms. Lonis Croft, you have just about a little over a minute left.
Okay. Would the strength you're referring to have to do with the weight of the vessel using angelic wood?
The weight of the vessel is something that gets a little bit confusing out in the public. The reality is that the vessel actually weighs only about 10 long tons more than what it previously had. So it's not the weight of the angelique that is an issue with it. It is the type of vessel and just what it is. Had we rebuilt Bluenose 2 exactly as she had been previously and, you know, ignored all of the standards that had to be met, there still would have been a question about whether or not that wooden rudder, if you looked and said, is this the safest thing? Our answer would have been no, that wooden rudder actually wasn't the safest thing. And my understanding is that in the past, the wooden rudder has actually broken in use.
How much has ABS classification cost so far?
No. We don't have an exact number for that, and again, some of that cost will be reflected in the change orders and in that process as that unfolds.
But you do pay a fee to ABS on a regular basis because their inspectors are on, I've been on the boat with when the inspector has been there.
So, I'm just looking here. 32?
Order, the time has expired, and unlike the World Cup, I'm not permitted to add extra time during pauses. So perhaps that's information that the deputy's indicating that she can provide to the committee. Before we go to the deputy minister's closing comments, Mr. Houston, do you have a comment you wish to make?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm just interested in this the document that was tabled today. I'm asking that if you can find out the source of this document and maybe if the witnesses have seen this document prior to today.
Thank you, Mr. Houston. I know the request is made. Who are you requesting to provide the? Ms. Dean?
I haven't seen this record. I will just share that with you. So it looks like it might be a record of the builder with respect to the timeline for the rudder.
Thank you, Mr. Houston. Ms. Dean, we would like to give you this opportunity now to provide some closing comments.
Okay. Thank you very much. As I said earlier, since becoming Deputy Minister of Communities, Culture, and Heritage last fall, I've had an opportunity to gain a greater understanding of the complexities associated with this project, and I can appreciate that Nova Scotians and many Canadians miss their sailing ambassador and are growing increasingly frustrated by the fact that she's not accessible to them. I also respect the fact that taxpayers want to know how their funds have been used and why the project is costing more than originally estimated. I hope I've been able to clarify some of that for you. I've attempted to share as much as I could today based on your questions, and we'll certainly follow up on some of the additional questions that you have. We do welcome the findings of the Auditor General's report when it's released, and hope that we can certainly learn from his observations. But one of the things that I would like to say is that we shouldn't lose sight of the importance of ensuring this vessel is fully compliant with modern construction and safety standards. The province is not prepared to compromise quality or safety when it comes to carrying passengers and crew on board Bluenose 2. Tragic disasters like the Concordia and the Bounty underscore the importance of quality and safety in today's vessels. The due diligence required to have the vessel classified by the American Bureau of Shipping ensures that Bluenose 2 will meet the highest possible international safety and operating standards. So to conclude, I hope that when Bluenose 2 resumes her role as sailing ambassador for the province, that we once again celebrate our shipbuilding expertise and proud maritime heritage. Thank you very much for inviting me here today.
Thank you very much, Ms. Dean. We don't have really any business on our agenda other than the witness today. Our next meeting is scheduled for September 10th with Mr. Darrow, and it is also on the on the Bluenose 2 discussion that we've had today. Mr. Houston, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I'd like to, Mr. Chair, thank you very much. I'd like to make a motion that the committee meet again next week to further discussion on the project, and that this time we invite those additional people that are now involved in overseeing the project. And I'd like to ask that we meet next week and invite the Premier, the Minister, and also Mr. Darrow. So the motion is that we meet next week with those witnesses.
Thank you, Mr. Houston. Are there any comments on that motion? Ms. McDonald?
Thank you. We will be supporting this motion.
Mr. Rankin?
Just a brief comment. I'm sure most of the members know the Premier's out of the country on a trade mission, so he won't be available for that.
Okay. Mr. Houston, do you wish to, we should put the motion to a vote. The motion before the committee is that we have the Premier and Mr. Rankin, I recognize he is not likely available given he's out of the country, Mr. Darrow and the Minister Tony Ince as well, to be here as a witness for a meeting next week on the same topic of the Bluenose 2. All those in favor say aye. Those opposed? Motion is defeated. Mr. Houston?
With that in mind, I think it's obviously disappointing to me that motion would be defeated. This is an important issue for Nova Scotians, and it's one that's top of mind. I just think that September is too late to leave this issue. By the time September rolls around, Mr. Darrow would have received, I guess, over $60,000 of compensation from the taxpayers of this province. So Mr. Darrow is a very capable person. I would suspect that he is up to speed on the file at this stage. And I'd like to propose that we bring him to a meeting and we don't wait to September for that. So I guess I would amend my motion to say that the committee meet next week with Mr. Darrow.
Thank you, Mr. Houston. Ms. Lonis-Croft.
I'd like to clarify, Mr. Darrow is already employed by the Premier's office. He is receiving no extra money for this.
Okay. Any other comments? Ms. McDonald?
I think it does make a great deal of sense that we have an additional meeting and that we do it next week and bring Mr. Darrow forward to discuss. And I, just for clarification, I think if my colleague doesn't mind, I think he was making reference to the new consultant that is on the file. And, you know, we're seeing tick, 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 times passing, the money continues to mount, and the ship isn't in the water yet, really. So Nova Scotians are concerned about this issue, and let's talk to the guy who's in charge, ultimately, in the Premier's office. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Rankin?
Just a quick comment. I don't see a correlation between when this project's going to be finished with the consultant and bringing the members into this committee for questioning. Again, I've said it last week that this file is relatively new to the oversight of the Deputy Minister, Darrow, and I think that we should give him the opportunity to come up with some solid recommendations to go forth. And this committee has a very strict mandate to analyze the administration of departments. It's not to bring forth new policy, and it's definitely not a committee that brings politics to it, and I think that we should all be cognizant of that.
There is some, Mr. Houston?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I guess the point I wanted to clarify is Mr. Darrow is a very capable person. We've heard conflicting stories through the media and possibly today as to what his exact role might be. He's clearly playing a role. And having been on the job, so to speak, now, especially by next week for a sufficient period of time, he will have or he should have a good understanding of the issues. And I think the people of Nova Scotia deserve to hear from him what his understanding of the issues is, and hear his thought process on how they may be resolved so we can see see the project through to conclusion. And I don't think that the taxpayers of Nova Scotia should be made to wait till September to hear what his thoughts on the issue are. I think they deserve to know now, and that's why we'd like to see him before this committee next week.
Okay, there appears to be some disagreement on the motion, therefore it should be put to a vote, and the motion is to bring Mr. Darrow, the current deputy minister, before the committee to discuss Bluenose 2 next week. All those in favor say aye. Those opposed? Motion is defeated. Is there any other comments or any other? We do have one important piece of business, actually, that we do have to vote on, and that is the subcommittee and agenda and procedures record of decision from June 11th. There are five witnesses that have been approved by the subcommittee, and you'll see them there. Each of you has a copy of that record of decision. Could we have a motion for approval of those witnesses? It has been moved by Ms. McDonald. All those in favor? Those opposed? I'm going to have to ask for people to vote again because it's not clear to me what the numbers are. All those in favor of the decision? Those opposed? The motion is defeated. So with that, unless there is a motion that